The facts about yesterday's storm are staggering.
The sub-zero temperature.
A mountain of snow making roads impassable.
Something is up with the weather.
I'm weatherman Alex Beresford, and in this series, I'm investigating why Britain's extreme recent weather has been so bad.
Hailstones coming through their open windows last night.
I'm looking at floods.
I can't believe it.
Dangerous storms. Intense cold and baking heat. I'm trawling through centuries of British history to compare weather from the past
is going to take place
with our weather now. And I'm seeking out the science that can tell us if this is the most extreme British weather we've ever had. This time, I'm investigating heat waves. With British weather, it's often rain that gets top billing. But that could soon change because within a generation, severe heat waves in Britain may become the norm. I'll investigate what causes a heat wave, and by looking back through summer's past, I'll discover why they've been so rare and so deadly. In 2003, over 70,000 people died across Europe and the UK as a result of the heat. To find out how heat waves kill people, I'll be putting my body on the line. Thanks to global warming, the long-term forecast is for warmer summers in the century to come. But with the heat waves also due to get more severe, could all that summer heat turn out to be too much of a good thing?
In 2013, after six washouts in a row, Britain finally had a summer to remember. It didn't break any records, but all the same, for most of July, Britain was in the grip of a heat wave.
It started on July the 3rd, when the country woke up to the rare sight of a perfect summer's day, followed by another and another. And when Andy Murray sent the nation into ecstasy at Wimbledon a week later, the sun was still shining. By July the 13th, the temperature in the southeast hit 30 degrees Celsius, a blistering 86 degrees Fahrenheit. We put work on the back burner and let our hair down.
We are in the midst of a heat wave, the longest we've had since 2006.
A heat wave is defined as five consecutive days with average temperatures 5 degrees Celsius higher than usual. By the middle of July, that applied to many parts of England and Wales.
The heat wave was an unexpected bonus for most of us, and just the kind of summer weather we've been waiting for. But when temperatures remained high for several days and nights in a row, things became uncomfortable.
And now the Met Office has issued a heatwave alert to two more areas of England where temperatures have remained above 30 Celsius for the sixth day running.
After 2 weeks of intense heat, the holiday atmosphere started to wilt. The government issued a series of health warnings about the danger of overheating, and emergency units around the country were filling up fast.
And the heat alert is now a serious health alert. And as the country continues to swelter, emergency services come under pressure.
We've been taking about 1,000 more emergency calls in our central London control rooms every day. And of that, about 20% of those calls are categorised as immediately life-threatening.
As temperatures climbed higher, three soldiers died from heat exhaustion on military exercises in South Wales. And there were several fatal swimming accidents as people risk cooling off in rivers and quarries. It felt like the heat was becoming too much of a good thing.
Could do with it cooling off just a bit, you know, just for a day.
Love a bit of rain now, a bit of relief.
The countryside was tinder dry. And forest fires like this one in Epping erupted around the country. The walkie-talkie building in London was renamed the Walkie Scorchy, as its concave shape reflected the sun's rays and melted the paint on the cars below.
This is
gets the top of your feet the worst if you're wearing leather shoes. You can't stand it for too long.
Yesterday, people were filming this bike saddle that had actually caught a light.
Temperatures of over 90 degrees Celsius were recorded before the developers screened it off. It was a memorable summer, but because it had been six long years since our last heatwave, this one seemed to take us completely by surprise.
To understand why the summer of 2013 was so hot and why weather like that is so rare here, we need to get back to basics and look at the weather patterns that affect British summertime.
Britain has well-defined seasons, and that's because of our position on the surface of the planet.
The Earth tilts at 23 degrees, and by midsummer, our part of the Northern Hemisphere is in daylight for about two-thirds of the day. Now, you think that would be enough to make it nice and hot here, but most years, something else spoils the party.
British summertime is at the mercy of the jet stream and the unsettled conditions it can bring our way. But a seasonal change in the jet stream means that it doesn't always dominate our summer weather.
In the summertime, the flow of the jet stream is relatively weak, and that means it can be diverted by weather systems in its path.
The heat contrast between the Arctic and the tropics gives the jet stream its power. But in the summer, the Arctic warms up and the heat contrast is reduced. And that means the jet stream becomes weaker. So rather than flowing straight, it slows down and begins to drift. A weather system known as the Azores High moves north in the summer, and sometimes it stretches right up towards Europe. Air moves around in the atmosphere all the time, but when a large mass of air gathers in a single region, the weight of all that extra air pushing down on the surface creates what we call high pressure. And when the weakened jet stream meets this obstruction, it can be deflected away to the north. And when high pressure is in place over Britain, it has the power to control our summer weather. When the sun beats down, it creates a layer of warm air close to ground level. Being warm, that air is also buoyant, just like this helium-filled balloon.
Warm air wants to rise, but during a heat wave, high atmospheric pressure acts like a lid, holding the air down, stopping it from ascending.
With high pressure sitting over Britain, warm air near the surface remains trapped, and the country warms up. But eventually, the high pressure will weaken, allowing the jet stream to swing back towards the UK, and everything changes.
When the jet stream shifts to the south, it effectively blows the lid off all that high pressure, releasing the warm air that's been held near the surface, which is suddenly able to rise.
Primed with energy, the hot air races up through the atmosphere. As the air rises higher, it cools, and the water vapor it contains turns into water droplets. This is how clouds form. In the summer, air can have so much energy that it keeps rising up towards 10 kilometers, forming enormous cumulonimbus clouds, which are the building blocks of a thunderstorm. Kilometers up, water droplets become ice crystals, and as they move around in the cloud, they create static electricity. When enough charge is built up, a connection is made with the ground and a bolt of lightning is unleashed with a temperature hotter than the surface of the sun. At the end of the 2013 heatwave, huge thunderstorms broke out in the south of the country.
Whoa! That was major.
Overnight it tracked northwards. Lots of people were woken up by these huge lightning displays and the claps of thunder.
There were thousands of lightning strikes and the storm spread right across Britain. Scotland, lightning even started a fire in a block of flats in Greenock. The storms also brought torrential rain, and near Nottingham, almost 1.5 inches fell in less than an hour.
Look at that guy on his bike!
And with the ground baked hard by the heat wave, that led to flash floods.
The rain came roaring off the Pennines, ripped the tarmac up, went straight through 3 homes here.
We have an emergency. We're actually trapped in the pub. Have a look.
Outside, well and truly flooded.
It was a violent end to the heat wave, and while there were more hot spells that summer, none of them came close to those glorious 3 weeks in July. But this was far from being the most dramatic heat wave Britain has experienced. To learn about those, we need to look much further back in time. In 2003, events abroad dominated the headlines. And in April, the Iraqi regime was toppled.
These images broadcast around the globe.
But in August, another story was breaking much closer to home as summer temperatures began to build. Before the summer was over, hot weather would have ended the lives of around 2,000 people in Britain.
In 2003, Europe was gripped by a devastating heat wave. Temperatures soared and records tumbled. The sweltering conditions caused problems right across the continent.
In Britain, the heat really began to build in early August. And within days, temperatures in the southeast hit 32 degrees Celsius, a heady 90 degrees Fahrenheit.
Oyez! Welcome to a very, very, very hot London.
The Azores High had already spread right up into France, and now Britain was also affected by high pressure and cloudless skies. In the southeast, commuters suffered and temperatures even climbed so high that railway tracks began to warp in the heat.
The tracks can't cope with this heat, and to stop buckling, speed restrictions have caused delays and cancellations.
Records were tumbling fast, and for the first time ever, the UK hit the magic number of 100 degrees Fahrenheit in Kent on August the 10th. But as Britain sweltered, the images pouring in from around Europe were even more dramatic. Wildfires destroyed huge swathes of forests in Portugal and Italy. River levels in Germany dropped so low that ships couldn't get to inland ports. And in Switzerland, record temperatures melted glaciers and caused avalanches. Workers in France even had to hose down nuclear power plants as the reactor casings approached a dangerous 50 degrees Celsius. But for the public, the worst place to be was in the heart of Europe's biggest cities.
A heat wave in a city can be unbearable. During the day, the heat from the sun is soaked up by the buildings and streets, and it's released like a radiator at night time. The heat pours out of shops, offices, out of the buses, and also the cars. And this urban heat island effect can raise temperatures by as much as 10 degrees compared to the surrounding countryside.
And in 2003, that effect contributed to new record temperatures in cities right across continental Europe. Paris was the worst affected, and hospitals were soon inundated with victims of dehydration and heat stroke. August is when the French go on holiday, and with many medical staff on leave, the healthcare system was under real pressure. On August the 4th, 300 deaths were attributed to the heat. But when temperature and air pollution peaked around August the 12th, there were a staggering 2,000 extra deaths a day. And it wasn't only the elderly that suffered. There were deaths in all age groups, and across France, about 15,000 people were eventually killed by the heat. Jacques Chirac's government was criticised for what some perceived as a sluggish response. As hospitals struggled to deal with the number of bodies, temporary mortuaries were set up, and it's even reported that kitchen refrigerators were used to store the dead. Across the continent, over 70,000 people were killed, and the heat wave has been described as Europe's biggest natural disaster on record. To find out why the heat killed so many people in 2003, I've come to take a closer look at how the human body copes with high temperatures. So here at Loughborough University, Dr. Simon Hodder is going to subject me to an artificial heat wave.
Hi, Alex. How are you?
Nice to meet you. So, what are we doing today, then?
Right, today we're going to look at how the human body reacts to the extreme heat. And so, best thing for that is to get you into a climatic chamber. So we're going to monitor your heart rate and your core temperature. And the way we're going to do that is with a radio pill.
OK.
So it's a little micro-temperature sensor, which okay. you actually swallow.
Didn't feel a thing.
Heat stroke is what happens when core temperature gets out of control. So that will be closely monitored throughout the test, and my weight is checked too.
I thought I was 70.
It's crucial my heart rate doesn't get too high, so that will also be recorded as the chamber heats up.
So what is your heart rate at the moment? So that's the 93. I would have thought for somebody like you, probably 70 would be your resting heart rate.
Maybe I'm a bit nervous.
Yeah.
Most deaths in Paris came in a 10-day period when it was hotter than 33 degrees Celsius or 91 degrees Fahrenheit. So the temperature of the chamber is set to that level with a humidity of 65%.
Would you really feel that straight away?
Because I'm young and healthy, it could take a long time for my body to react to these conditions, but jogging on a treadmill will speed up my natural reactions for the purposes of the test.
Okay.
This one?
Yeah.
How long do I need to run for?
We're gonna be in here for an hour, Alex.
The lights really do feel like the sun on the back of my neck. It feels really clammy. I can really feel the humidity in this room.
I've only just started running, but my body's first line of defense against the heat is already working hard.
When we exercise, we start to produce sweat. That sweat dissipates over the surface of the skin, and it's the evaporation of the sweat off the skin that cools us down.
So 20 minutes into the test, I'm completely drenched, and that should be keeping me cool. But my core temperature tells a different story. Since the start of the test, it's risen steadily from a normal 37.1 to around 37.9 degrees Celsius. That may not sound like much, but every tenth of a degree is crucial, because even the healthiest of us can only cope with a very small rise in core temperature.
I can really feel the heat starting to get to me now, making me feel a little bit sluggish.
I'm finding it hard to stay cool, and Dr. Hodder explains why.
At the moment, we're sort of 65-70% humidity in this room, and that means for Alex that his ability to evaporate the sweat that he's producing is actually limited. So he's getting quite a lot of it that's sitting on his skin and not evaporating. She's not getting the cooling power.
The air is like a sponge. When it's dry, it can soak up a lot of water. But humid air struggles to soak up any more moisture. Because Britain and Europe sit next to the Atlantic Ocean, our heat waves are often humid. And that means our ability to cool down by sweating is limited.
I feel my legs getting heavier. I don't want to come up so high.
I haven't lost enough heat by sweating, and my core temperature has now risen to over 38 degrees Celsius. But as I sweat, I'm also losing vital salts and fluid. That can lead to a drop in blood pressure, which causes a form of fatigue known as heat exhaustion, the precursor to full-blown heat stroke.
So let's take it easy.
Coming up to an hour of being in here, the dangerous thing is that my body and my mind are not actually in tune. So my heart rate has been 178, 179.
My heart's working overtime, pushing warm blood away from my core in a desperate attempt to shed some more heat. If you have a weak heart, this kind of sudden strain can quickly lead to cardiac arrest. But despite a faster heartbeat, I'm still heating up.
I don't think I could go on much longer. My limbs are all starting to feel really heavy. It's just not enjoyable anymore.
That is your hour, Alex.
So, Simon, how long did I last and how much weight did I lose?
So, you're in there for the hour. You ran about 6 kilometres. And at the moment, it looks like you lost around about 0.75 of a litre of moisture and sweat. So you're a bit closer to being 70 kilos than you were at the start of study.
My core temperature peaked at 38.9 degrees Celsius, which means I was at risk of heat exhaustion. Despite all that sweating and an increase in my heart rate, my core temperature never stopped rising. Under these conditions, heat stroke can develop extremely quickly. In just 10 minutes, core temperature can rise to as high as 41 degrees Celsius, only 2 degrees hotter than I got. That's when cells begin to die, which can lead to permanent damage to the kidneys or brain, and then full organ failure. Heat stroke can be avoided by moving somewhere cool and well ventilated and taking on fluid, but that isn't always possible.
Stretchered away after collapsing in a traffic jam, one of Britain's casualties of the heat wave. The extreme temperatures caught the country by surprise and took their toll.
Many people do recover from heat stroke, but tragically, in 2003, the heat was deemed responsible for the deaths of more than 2,000 people in Britain. And as we keep looking back in time, we find another heat wave. And this time, it was the effects on the British landscape that were felt most acutely, as Britain faced its worst drought on record. At a time when punks were elbowing their way onto the scene and Concorde was making its first commercial flight, Britain also had a Formula One world champion in the shape of James Hunt. But 1976 will also go down as a heatwave year that has stuck in the collective memory like no other.
The summer of 1976 was the most dramatic British heatwave of the 20th century. With over 2 months of hot and sunny weather, it was a summer that seemed to go on forever. But it will be forever associated with one word: drought.
The heat wave came after one of the driest 12 months on record, and by early summer, the prospect of a drought was already on the cards right across England and Wales.
This area is just one of four major parts of Britain bracing themselves for the worst drought for 150 years.
With no rain in some places for 45 days, the nation's water supplies were on the verge of running out, triggering scenes like this in South Wales.
7 o'clock last night, teams of waterboard engineers began wrestling with the underground valves and stopcocks as Operation Cutoff began for more than 50,000 homes. It's an exercise that will be repeated every night for the foreseeable future.
Standpipes were installed on street corners, and things became so desperate that there was even an organised attempt by Sikhs to pray for rain.
It's all the idea of the temple's leader, Dr. Mangat.
You've lived here quite a few years. With your experience of British weather, how confident are you that it will rain?
100% confident that within the second fortnight, there would be definite rain.
A minister for drought was even appointed, as the lack of water became critical.
thanks to water shortages, crops failed, and prices rocketed. The heat had a stranglehold on the economy, and inflation soared.
The summer of 1976 goes down as the warmest 3 months in recorded history, and in part, that warmth was sustained by the drought itself.
In all heat waves, the evaporation of moisture is very important. When there's moisture in the ground and it's sunny weather, then that moisture will evaporate into the atmosphere.
And that evaporation uses energy, which would otherwise have heated the air. It's only when all the moisture has gone that the situation changes.
So when you start to run out of moisture, when all this moisture has been evaporated away, suddenly the sunlight can start directly heating the ground, and that effectively warms up the atmosphere. And that's when you do get these severe heat waves.
With all the moisture gone and the dry conditions contributing to high temperatures, this heat wave had one more trick up its sleeve.
Britain was left bone dry. Rivers were empty, the soil was cracking, and vegetation was completely dehydrated. The perfect conditions for something associated usually with California or the Australian bush.
In 1976, Derek Dawson was a young fireman in Staffordshire, and a fire here in Bury Bank Wood was one of scores he attended that summer.
When we arrived, the old embankment of the wood was well alight. It was horrendous. As soon as he caught hold of a tree, you'd hear this almighty whoosh. It was so tinderbox dry, there was nothing to stop it.
The fire in Staffordshire was just one of thousands across the UK, fueled by an endless supply of bone-dry undergrowth. And when fire engines couldn't get close enough, many firemen battled the flames with their bare hands.
It was a case of going in like this with your beaters, and you would be like this because all the embers would be coming at your face.
Back in 1976, health and safety wasn't really top of the list. We were very much left to our own devices. Very often we actually put ourselves in danger because obviously the idea was to tackle these fires and to get them out. Everything about it was so unreal.
Just flares up, you know, and it gets out of hand. Really, we haven't got enough bodies to control the fire at all.
We were really stretched to the limit. You were working really on an adrenaline rush. Very memorable time, so never forget it. Never.
In the last week of August, the heavens opened and the fires were put out for good. Britain let out a collective sigh of relief and life slowly returned to normal. This heat wave was notable for how long it lasted, but the daily maximum temperatures were not record-breaking. To find a heat wave where maximum temperatures were very high, we have to travel even further back in time.
This is the Gaumont British News.
In the First World War, many British troops sustained themselves in the trenches by drawing on memories of far happier times back in Blighty. Between the turn of the century and the Great War was a decade of peace and prosperity. The Playboy King, Edward VII, was on the throne, and this short period of warmth now bears his name.
Edwardian summer, another word. To many, in retrospect, those 10 years are among the sunniest.
There was a hot spell in 1906, and that was followed by another in 1911, when the great and the good enjoyed one of the warmest summer heat waves on record.
In 1911, Britain was gripped by a heat wave that lasted nearly the entire summer, and the papers were just crammed full of pictures of the public enjoying the sunshine. Just imagine this being on the front page of a Red Top today. But I'm pretty sure the girls wouldn't be wearing all this clothing. They'd be in 5 bikinis with the headline Scorchio.
Eastbourne saw 384 hours of sunshine across July, That's over 12 hours a day, which remains a British record. But not everyone was lucky enough to be relaxing on the English Riviera.
You know, what's striking about looking at these pictures of the heatwave is the division between the classes. If you were rich, it was one big garden party that lasted the entire summer. If you were poor, it was a very different experience. People really struggled, often slept outside because their homes were poorly ventilated. And imagine working in a factory where the heat was just unbearable.
As conditions deteriorated, heat-related deaths columns became a common sight in newspapers. The young were particularly vulnerable, and during some weeks in August, several hundred babies are reported to have died in the UK. Before the heatwave, the average figure had been around 18 per week. 1911 was a severe heatwave, with record temperatures that would stand for some 79 years. And looking even further back, similar hot summers keep cropping up, but seemingly at random.
Looking back at average summer temperatures in the last 500 years, no clear pattern emerges. A hot summer in one year can be followed by a cool and damp one in the next.
Some years, high pressure spreads further across Europe and turns the weakened jet stream away from us to produce a few weeks of constant sunshine. Scientists have not yet found any single underlying cause for these conditions, and that makes it hard to predict when the next heat wave might happen. The jet stream can have a big effect on temperatures in Britain from one summer to the next. But looking back much further to medieval Britain, we find a time when temperatures were notably higher, and not just for the odd summer, but throughout the seasons. And it's a period that lasted for hundreds of years. Looking back, I found that Britain has experienced sporadic hot summers over the last 500 years. With other kinds of weather, it's possible to find patterns over time, such as clusters of stormy years or colder winters. But summer temperatures jump up and down from one year to the next, and there are no obvious clusters in the last few centuries. Going further back though, a long-term warming pattern does emerge, although it has nothing to do with heat waves. 1,000 years ago, Britain experienced an entirely different kind of warmth. Rather than extreme summer heat, this was an increase in overall annual temperatures, and it lasted for hundreds of years. It came before thermometers existed, but it's been deduced from written records of when snow melted or trees blossomed each spring, and also scientific data from tree rings, which tells us about the climate across each year. So between about 900 and 1200 AD, annual temperatures in Britain were relatively higher than they were for several centuries before or after that. It's known as the medieval warm period, and it brought fewer frosts, better growing conditions, and good harvests. So what caused this time of warmth? To find out, I've come to a rather cold and damp part of northwest Scotland, where a key piece of evidence has been uncovered. To get to it, I need the help of local caving expert, Alan Jeffries.
Doing your
hello, hit. Welcome to sunny Sutherland.
This is Bob.
How you doing?
And John.
Okay.
You've got a lot on underneath. This is Scotland's best caving district, really. The longest caves in Scotland are up here.
And you know them like the back of your hand?
Yes, except I'll be wearing gloves today. they are interesting caves, you know. They're very, very old limestone.
We're heading for a cave where scientists made a fascinating discovery when they took rock samples from here a few years ago.
I'm not quite sure what I've let myself in for, but let's go in.
These tunnels have been carved out of the soft limestone by rainwater trickling down from the hills above.
Next bit of a drop, so we'll go in feet first.
OK.
As the water hollowed out these caves over thousands of years, it also left behind some crucial evidence.
This is a stalactite which formed dripping down from the ceiling like that. And in brief, how these were formed was that, as you can see, there are cracks in the roof here, which we call joints, and there is water seeping down from the surface. You can see
the drops. Yeah.
Well, these drops will be charged with carbonic acid, which the water picked up from the peat and the soil on the surface. It's acid, therefore it's been dissolving limestone as it came through. When it reaches a void, the water evaporates and it will deposit the dissolved limestone on the roof. You can see little tiny bits beginning to form until you get something like this. But that's how they were formed.
So what do the formations in this cave tell us about the climate in this area?
Now, every time there was an atmospheric or a climatic change on the surface, that would be reflected in the amount of stalactite matter deposited. Obviously, if there's wet conditions, more water will come through the roof, more limestone will be dissolved, and more growth will occur as a result. So if it's a fat band, it means there's a wet period, and if it's a narrow band, then it was a dry period when there was hardly any drip.
The technique for analysing cave deposits is well established thanks to work in other caves around the world. The formations are cut open to reveal bands, which can then be analysed one by one.
Scientists have been able to date the band by the decay of the radioactivity, which tells us that there was between about 900 and 1200 AD, which means that just about the time of the Crusades, there was a very wet period in Scotland. So nothing's changed there.
The rock formations in this cave allow us to build a picture about the climate here in the distant past. They tell us that when Britain was warmer during the medieval period, it was also very wet. And that provides us with a vital clue.
The combination of warm and wet tells us that 1,000 years ago, the jet stream was often positioned right over the UK. Today, when the jet stream is overhead in the winter months, Britain becomes stormy and mild, just like the winter of 2013-14. We were battered by endless storms, but there were also very few frosts. But that's not always the case, because we also get our fair share of cold winters. But in medieval Britain, it looks like our climate was dominated by warmer, wetter winters for a very long time. Annual temperatures may have been similar to a warm year in the 20th century, but they seem to stay warm more or less for 300 years. That brought better growing conditions, and 1,000 years ago, medieval Britain thrived. That was the past, but to find out what conditions might be like in the future, we need to look at processes that change our temperature far more dramatically, across even longer periods of time. And rather than warmth, those processes have the potential to bring long-lasting cold to Britain, because the entire planet could be standing on the brink of a new ice age. That kind of drastic shift in temperature is triggered by the immense gravitational forces that propel the Earth through space. The Sun is our ever-present source of heat, but because the position of the Earth relative to the Sun changes, the heating of our planet is not always the same. I can show you how those changes lead to ice ages with a simple demo, using a stone as my planet Earth and a paraffin lamp as my Sun.
The Earth orbits the Sun once every year, and over time, the shape of that orbit changes very slightly. So sometimes it's more circular, and other times it's more elliptical.
When the orbit is relatively circular, the Earth is heated quite evenly on its journey around the Sun. But as the orbit stretches into more of an ellipse, our distance from the Sun varies much more, sometimes the Earth is closer to the Sun, sometimes much further away.
It also tilts and wobbles on its axis.
The tilt of the Earth's axis changes over time, and it also loops around in space. And here in the Northern Hemisphere, these movements determine how much sunlight hits the surface at each point in the year. Altogether, these changes are known as the Milankovitch cycles, and as they shift back and forth, the heating of the planet varies across the seasons and over thousands of years. One very important factor is how much heat we receive during the summer months, because that has a huge effect down here on the surface.
In winter, snow and ice builds up, and in the heat of summer, it melts away. But if summer is cooler, not all of it disappears. And if you get a series of cooler summers, then year after year, snow and ice builds up until eventually you get glaciers and ice sheets.
That's how ice ages begin. And in each one, ice sheets spread down from the Arctic, often covering the northern half of the British Isles, which becomes a very different looking place. Matching the Milankovitch cycles, each ice age lasts around 100,000 years, and then the ice recedes again during much shorter, warm periods called interglacials, which last around 10,000 years. We're living in an interglacial now, and during this period of relative warmth, humans have built the modern world. But our interglacial has lasted over 11,000 years, and it may now be perilously close to its end. Changes in the tilt and wobble of our axis mean our summers should start to get cooler, perhaps in just a couple of thousand years, and that means the next ice age could be just around the corner.
But here's the incredible thing. There's a new factor in the equation now, humans. Our emissions are warming the atmosphere so much that some scientists believe that we could actually delay the next ice age.
The idea that humans could interfere with ice ages is hard to believe. But one team of scientists has found a way to try and determine how things will play out in the future. Using ice cores and other data, they examined an interglacial period 780,000 years ago, when the Earth was poised to enter an ice age just like today.
If you want to know, for example, when the next ice age would be expected, what you might do is look back in the past for when the changes in the seasonality of the solar radiation, the intensity of Northern Hemisphere summers, was the same as it is today. If we line up the records for 780,000 years ago and today, you find that we would expect a glaciation to start maybe within 1,500 years.
The lesson from the past is that our current interglacial might only last another 1,500 years, at which point ice would again begin to take hold.
But probably expect that only if everything else was the same. But if you look in closer detail, it turns out that that happened last time only because CO2 was relatively low.
In the deep past, it seems that when summers became cooler, ice ages began. But since then, the burning of fossil fuels has added huge amounts of carbon dioxide to the atmosphere, which has become much better at trapping the sun's heat. This extra warmth could stop the next ice age in its tracks.
Human activities, certainly since the Industrial Revolution, definitely has postponed the next ice age.
So mankind now seems to be in charge of global temperature. The next reduction in summer sunshine may not be enough to let ice sheets grow, because global warming is heating the planet up. Future ice ages probably will happen one day, but only when levels of carbon dioxide start to come down, and we don't know when that might happen. So we needn't worry about ice sheets advancing across Britain anytime soon. But unfortunately, this could be a case of out of the frying pan and into the fire. By averting the next ice age, we've also caused other problems, and not in the distant future, but right now.
We're likely to see warming in Britain that is unprecedented in the last 1,000 or 2,000 years. The rises in temperatures that we can expect in response to the greenhouse gas increases will be very substantial in the context of human history. The exact amount is difficult to pinpoint, but if we do continue to emit greenhouse gases at the rate we're doing, we can expect rises of, you know, 3 or 4 degrees are quite likely by 2100.
And that warming will have a huge impact on British summer weather.
The intense heat of 2003 across continental Europe was unprecedented around the last 500 years, possibly longer. But in the future, we can expect this type of event. It'd be like a taster of the future, really, because research does indicate that the chances of some of the most severe heat waves occurring has increased.
Climate change means average temperatures in Britain have already risen above 20th century levels and the levels of the medieval warm period. This warming will continue, and by the middle of the century, the kind of heat seen in 2003 could actually represent an average British summer. In this warmer version of the UK, heat waves may still only happen every few years, but when they do, they're likely to get far hotter, drier, and more dangerous as the decades pass. As with every type of British weather, the extreme events of the past have helped us to understand how bad recent events have really been. But as global warming changes the picture, events in the future may yet surpass anything we've seen so far.
Are they about to be a man down? Things are unravelling on the island with Bear Grylls next tonight. Then at 10, if you think getting your ear pierced makes you brave, wait till you see the Torture King in Man vs. Weird at 10.